scarlet thread woven in my life. The only thing I find is holding me. The crimson flood poured out on my nail-pierced hands leading in my life. The only thing I find is holding me. Your precious blood poured out on my life. The only thing I find that covers me. The only thing I find is hope.
I'm going to tell you what, while I was singing that song, I looked at this side of the building. I looked here. I looked here on the other end. Just this week alone, look how many families were affected on this side. Look at Brother Melvin and the grandkids on this side. Then I've got my family.
Come on, man.
How easy. It could have been. Those seats over here are empty. Those seats over here are empty. And my family. You have no guarantee. When you go to work every morning, coming home from work in the evening, you don't even have a guarantee that you'll walk out that door. My family left this building last Sunday while I was working. And never made it past Southridge. How easy could it have been? That'd been the end of it. That'd been done. That'd been it. That'd be gone. You have no guarantee. I know it's hard to take that first step. I've been in that seat once too. But you take that first step. You don't remember the rest of it. You don't. I promise you, you don't. Before you know it, you're almost at a dead run. If there's anybody here that's lost, please take that courage. Take it first. Just take it first.
Demons have to flee when I say Jesus.
Bless you, sis.
Go ahead, sis.
let's stand across the building. Luke chapter 7, if you've got your Bibles, you that can stand, you that cannot, God knows. Luke chapter 7. Let's begin reading here in verse 39. Bible says, "Now when the Pharisee which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself, saying, This man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answering said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to tell unto thee. And he said, Master, say on. He said, There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me therefore which of them will love him the most. Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And he said unto him, Thou hast rightly judged. And he turned to see the woman and said unto Simon, Seest thou this woman? I entered into thine house, and thou gavest me no water for my feet, but she hath washed my feet with her tears, and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little." Let us pray this morning. Heavenly Father, God of heaven, we thank you so much for the service we had. God, we thank you, Lord, for the promise of sins forgiven. We thank you, God, for the songs of Zion. Lord, we certainly thank you for the wonderful works and the testimonies we've had in our own church down through the week. We love you this morning. We pray that you'd anoint our lips of clay. God, that you'd reach out and touch another soul this morning, or many, in Jesus' name and amen. You may be seated. We thank you for standing to honor God this morning. Want to preach the Lord being our helper on a test, on a love test. We're going to take a test this morning. And don't worry, because I'm not a good teacher, so the test's not hard. You can be happy right there. I don't like tests. I never have. All going through school and high school and on up into college, I have never, ever got excited over a test. Matter of fact, I'd get nervous. I'd get sick to my stomach. My hands would get sweaty. I'd begin to panic. My favorite teacher in all of college was an air conditioning teacher, HVAC. He said, "Now listen, I'll let you do it together, and I'll let you use your book." Hallelujah. That's the best. That was the best teacher I ever had. And listen, for the life of me, he'd say, "All right," he'd hand out the test, and he'd say, "Now you can use somebody, but you got to talk quietly. You can use your book too. It's right there. I'll be back in a little bit." And he'd leave. It turned into a huge group session. The entire 40 kids in our class would begin to, "Hey, what'd you get for one?" It was a good community thing. But he realized that we were learning by going back and forth and talking about it. Some of us may not have, but down through it, I realized that you can be a test taker and not make it gruesome in the process. So this morning, you pray for the preacher. I want you to look at the Word of God. The Bible said that there comes a woman, and she comes... Or there comes a man, a Pharisee, and he says, "Lord," and he talks to Jesus. He said, "I want you to eat with me. I want you to come back to my house. And the Bible said that Jesus came, and when he came, people came with him. It was more or less not just a private invitation, but those who will, those who could, those who were allowed while there was room, they came to the house. More or less a party, if you will. And as they have all gathered around there in this gathering of people, and while they're standing there, this woman comes out of nowhere. She falls down. She begins to anoint the Lord, and she begins to cry, and she begins to wash his feet. And as this is going on, listen, the Pharisee stands back and says, if he was a prophet, he would know what manner of woman this is. Now, we're going to take a love test this morning. Listen, and it's going to be simple. We'll go through it together. And I took a love test the other day on the internet. All these crazy things pop up, and it says, are you in love? Take this test. So I clicked it just out of sheer curiosity. Sometimes you're curious, and I knew I was in love. I know I love my wife, and I love my children. I love my church, and I love God. But out of sheer curiosity, I want to share with you the first question that it asked me. It said, how long have you known them? Is it longer than 6 months? And I thought, you know, that's ironic, because there are those that come to the house of God sometimes, and they don't last that long. They come in, they get lifted up on this excitement, they hear some songs that make them feel good, and they leave unchanged because they fell in love with a song and not with a God. They fell in love with a group of people and not with a holy God who has redeemed them. Oh, yes. Amen. Listen, you know why church splits happen? Because people fall in love with a man and not in love with the man. Amen. Listen, he said, if you love the brethren whom you have seen, how can you love God whom you've not seen? So how long have you known God? How long have you been in love with him? The next question that he asked, it said, do you interact with this person, or do you just admire from afar off? I'm telling you this morning, I feel preaching easy this morning. Listen, do you love God so much that you have an interaction with him, or do you just know about him afar off? Have you just heard about him? Have you just seen his works? Oh God, hallelujah. Listen, have you just heard of his works? Or have you felt his presence? Have you seen his works upon your life? Or are you just standing on the outside looking in? Amen. Have you have an interaction with God? Or do you just admire from afar off? Because I'm telling you, we can darken the church doors every time the doors are open. We can admire from afar off, but no change will take place until we begin to interact with God, till we accept him as Savior, till he changes us and makes us a new creature in Christ Jesus. How are we doing so far on the test? Bible said, you say, preacher, that's simple. I'm telling you, when the Pharisees stood there, who was a Pharisee? They were the religious Jew of the day who had the doctrine, who had no heart. Oh, God, listen to me. You can study this word all you want to. You can hold to it. You can look at it. But until you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, listen, you will miss the mark this morning. The next question was, what best describes you? A couple? Casual dating? Close just friends? Friends? Acquaintances? Or I don't even know the person. I realized as I begin to take this test, I think this is a psychology test to try to find out who stalkers are in the world. They're red flagging themselves as they take this test. But I also realized this morning as I read this that there was many gathered this morning in that group of people inside the Pharisee's home. There was many that day that gathered around Jesus. Simon was there and the Pharisees was there. And there was other people besides this woman. But the problem was is only two of them really came in contact with Jesus Christ. Simon was there. No, we know his name was was Peter, and also this woman who begins to break open the alabaster box and anoint the Lord with oil and begin to weep. They're the only two people that have any contact with the Lord Jesus. There's a house full of us here this morning, but I'm telling you, you can be as close, amen, to the gate of heaven, and still the Bible says be a step between us and death. And the problem is if we leave here unchanged and unready to meet God, how would you describe your relationship with the Lord this morning? Are you a couple? Are you just acquaintances? You say, preacher, you can't do that with the Lord. Well, sure you can. You can come to church every single Sunday. You can be more faithful than some members and still miss heaven because you're just an acquaintance. You just bump shoulders with them. Time and time again, we read throughout the Word of God that God would do more miracles if they would believe. God would walk through the midst of the crowd of people as they're thronging Him, and He would walk right on through them because there was such a mob of people, they didn't even know what they were looking for. And I'm telling you this morning, you can be an acquaintance with Jesus. You can bump shoulders with Him all day long, and hell still be your home because you have no relationship with Him. You have not accepted Him as Savior. You've not looked at Him as your Redeemer. And listen, it will not get you to heaven to just come to church, even though that we should. The Bible says in Mark 12:30, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, with all thy strength, for this is the first commandment. The next question that it asked me said, have you had the feelings talk? Some of y'all hadn't dated in so long, you don't even know what I'm talking about anymore. Some of you are too young to date. Say amen right there, parents. I told McKinley, I said, you can't date till you're married. Sit right there. Listen, how many of you, like this preacher boy, raised in the house of God, raised right, raised in a good family, and I would get in trouble, and I'd cry out to God. I stand before you today knowing that God didn't hear my prayers. The only way that God hears my prayers is through Jesus Christ, and I wasn't praying anymore. He is the only one that sits on the right-hand side of God that makes intercession for you and I. So it's not about a feeling this morning. It's not about feeling good. It's not about what we think. It's about accepting the Lord into our life. Are we loving God with all of our heart, with all of our body, with all of our soul? Are we giving ourselves to God? See, there was another group that Jesus talked to in John chapter 8, and the Bible said that He stood before them and said, God's my Father. He sent me here to do great things. And they said, Joseph's your daddy. Your God's not, or your dad's not God. He can't be. He's not. You're blaspheming. And Jesus tells him, he said, you're of the seed of Abraham, but you do not the works of Abraham. He said, if God was your father, ye would have loved me. I'm telling you this morning, do you love God, or do you just lust after Him? Do you love the thought of God, or do you love God as your omnipresent, omniscient God who sits on the throne in which none is any higher, and that He is our Redeemer? He's bought us with a price, and therefore we're to glorify God. Or merely have you just had the talk with the Lord? I got a good next question. Some of these questions are good. I like them. The next question was, can you see yourself with anybody else? I'm telling you, this makes me want to run and shout. Yeah. Hey, let me tell you this morning, as humbly as I can, I can't see myself with anybody else.
Oh, God, I can't see myself with anybody. I can't find nobody who will love me like he will love me. I can't find anybody who would redeem such a worthless wretch as I was when I was lost and in the world, when I was on drugs and, listen, drinking my life away. Listen, I found somebody who said, if you would come and give yourself unto me, I would take you unto my own. I would under you underneath my, wings as a hen does her chicks. And I'm telling you this morning, God brought me in into the fold. He saved me and made me a new creature. I can't find myself. I can't find myself living with anybody else. I'm saying, he loves you, church. He loves you this morning. Ain't nobody do you like the Lord. I can't see myself with anybody else. I don't want nobody else. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, now listen, I can't find nobody that loves me like the Lord loves me. You say, preacher, but I can still love the Lord and love the world. Bible says that no man can serve two masters. Either he'll cleave to one and despise the other, or hate one and reject the other. No man can serve two masters. You can't love two gods. You can't go on. You have to know that he is the best one. You can't see yourself with anybody else this morning. Let me ask you, have you spent time courting with the Lord? Do you love him enough that you've spent time with him? Listen, and someone's asked me, where did you meet your wife? We met in church. We met at church revival. I met her dad at a conference, at a church conference. Because I have her this morning, she is my wife because of God. There's no other reason. It wasn't my handsomeness. It wasn't my charm. God knows it wasn't my money. It wasn't my health. All those things have gone. But I'm telling you this morning, the only reason she's my wife is because the Lord. Listen, I'm telling you, when you spend, I thought this morning, one of the greatest little things I read, they put in your pamphlet, make sure you read it, that you seek the Lord first. I told somebody, matter of fact, it was my Sunday school teacher. She was a great inspiration to me getting saved. I had grown out of her class. At class, I began to preach and I told her, I said, I'm praying for a wife. She said, don't you dare pray for a wife. She said, what you need to do is in Matthew chapter 6, she said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all these things shall be added. I said, you're right. I begin to get hungry and thirsty for the word of God. Not only the word of God, but the work and the will of God for my life. And God has moved me, has guided me, has directed me, has supplied all of my need according to his riches and glory. And I'm telling you, the church this morning, lost friend, God will continue to supply your very need this morning. The next question it asked me, have you kissed? That's it. It was a couple, three little words. Have you kissed? I thought, well, that's not a Bible question. Bible says you ought not touch a woman. Man, that's old-fashioned right there. Thank you, Brother Ron. And if you are, you ought to have a wife. That's what it goes on to say. Listen to me. Have you came in contact with the Lord? Or do you just stare afar off? Have we had a personal touch from God? I know we've seen God protect our church many times over this last week. I've been in and out of hospitals all week long, and that's fine. I love it. I love to pray with people, minister unto people. But you have to understand, my limitations stop with my flesh, and God begins to take over. We don't need a world that's touched by my hand. We need a world that's touched by God. We need the Lord. We need people not to have a relationship with their pastor or with the church. We need the church once again to have a relationship with God, because he's the one that supplies the need. He's the one that heals the blind and heals the deaf and heals the lame. And he's still the one that heals a rotten soul and changes a man's heart of stone and puts in a heart of flesh. It's still a touch from God. The next question it asked me, and I promise you I ain't making these up. It said, how do you feel when you're around them? Yeah. I thought, well, that's a good question. When you're around God's people, when you're around the Lord, when His Spirit gets high, when you're, hey man, when you're in heavenly places, how do you feel this morning? Do you feel uplifted and strengthened and strong, and you've been on your knees praying and God give you some deliverance, God give you some strength? Or this morning, do you feel condemned? Do you feel like there's something missing? Do you feel like there's a part of you that's not whole, and money's not for satisfying, and company's not satisfying? A woman or a man will never satisfy it. Listen, wealth or fame does not satisfy. There's a void. Do you feel condemned, or do you feel comforted this morning? Because I'm telling you, this morning you can leave the house of God here, right here this morning, being comforted, knowing that He is with you. He'll never leave you. But the choice is yours, whether you love God or whether you don't. The next question that it asked me was, how do they act around you in a group? That's a pretty good question. You know, some people talk to people, and I've been out of high school, thank the Lord, for a few years now, and I've not been around the dating scene for years and years. But you see people that talk in the corners and the shadows, and then they are never around each other in the groups of friends. Or sometimes a girl or sometimes a boy wants to be friends or wants to date somebody when nobody else is watching. Man, I feel good this morning. Bible says that if we're ashamed of the Lord, He would be ashamed of us. He said, if you deny me before men, then I would deny you before my heavenly Father. How do you act around the Lord? I'm telling you, I'm the same here in the hospital, nursing home, don't matter where I am. I can laugh and have a good time. But the most important thing is that we're right with God. Some people think that when you come to the house of God that you have to dry up. You're an old stick in the mud and you just got no joy, got no happiness. But I'm telling you, I haven't lost anything coming to the Lord. Matter of fact, He's done everything I ever need. And the next question asked me is, how do they act when they're alone with you? Shouldn't be no different. Should not be any different. Because He is the same yesterday, today, forevermore. Forever. God's never going to change. The greatest thing you can ever do is give your love to God, because He'll never change. He'll never fail you. He'll never let you down. He'll never turn aside. He'll always be there. He'll love you the same every single day. When Pastor has messed up, when Brother Hatfield's messed up, when you've messed up, God still loves you the same. He still loves me the same. He'll never love me any less or any more. He cannot love me any less or any more, because He's the same. He commended His love towards us, and that was His Son Jesus Christ to die on the cross of Calvary. Not only did He say He loved us, He proved that He loved us. How well do you think you know Him this morning? How well would you say, I know my wife. I know what she wants for breakfast. I know how she likes her coffee. I don't always get it for her, but I know what she likes. Hey, don't laugh. You're guilty too. If I want her to have a great vacation, I know where to take her. It's not Alaska, the snow ski. It's to the warm beach. I know her. How well do you think you know the Lord? The world would say He's a bigot. The world would say that's hate speech. The world would say He doesn't care. He's trying to restrain you. He's trying to restrict you. I'm telling you tonight, this morning, the Bible said they that have been touched by the Lord, they're redeemed and they've been set apart. The Bible said that when God set them free, He said those that are free indeed. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. That means freedom. Listen, tonight, God didn't come to restrain us. He came to take the chains up off of us. He came to take that which was burdened down in weight, in sin, and take it off of us, and let us run with patience a race that is set before us. One last thing, and this is my point. Only one out of all of us, I'll tell you. When I was growing up, might be different today. It wasn't proper. I'm the oldest boy. There's three girls and then a younger boy. My sisters were not allowed to pick up a phone and call a boy. Boy was allowed to call the house. Do they call for you? Do they call for you? I'm telling you, someone that loves you, they'll call for you. They'll call for you in person. They'll call for you over the phone. They'll send a letter. Someone who truly loves you. I've never found Satan, when I was in the world, call for me. I've never found him to pick up and say, "You feeling okay?" I've never found the world to say, "How's it going? How's life treating you? How's the deck of cards that you've been dealt and the hand that you have? How is the surgery going?" and all these things. But I've found over and over to be driving in the car and the Lord stop by and comfort me and call upon me. I've found when there's no money that He would call upon me and supply my need. When there's no food, I've found Him to be faithful to supply the need. I'm telling you, He calls upon you this morning. Has He called upon your heart? One last thing and we get out of the way. Heard a story about a little girl who sat on the outskirts of town, and when the king would come, the king would leave his kingship and leave his palace, and he would go into the city, and as he was going through the city, there would be people that would wave him down and say, "Oh, king, we want to give you food, and we want to supply that need," and they would feed him, and then he would travel on a little bit further down the street, and somebody else would wave him down and say, king, would you please take our garments? We want to make you an outfit, and we want to make you a robe," and they would give him a robe, and then he would continue on down the road, and somebody else would wave and say, "King, would you please just stay in our house? Would you abide with us for the night? Would you rest here? Would you find company here?" And he would stay with them. And finally, he went on back to the palace, and he came to his mind one day and said, "I wonder if I wasn't king, if they would love me this way. Would they love me and treat me with this much compassion and this much love if I wasn't king?" And he tells his guards, he says, "You don't tell a person what I'm going to do, but I want you to go out and get me a beggar's clothes. And I want you to bring them to me, and I don't want you to let anybody know." And he puts on those garments and goes out into the street. And first of all, he came to the man who fed him, and he said, "Get out of here, I don't have any food to you or for you." And he went on down the street to the lady who had dressed him in purple and fine clothes. And she said, "Go aside, I don't have anything for you. You're a beggar." And he goes down to where he had stayed many times. Listen, and when he stayed there, he knocked on the door, and the man said, "There's no room for you. There's no place for you here. There's nowhere that you can stay." And he goes on to the end of where his chariot had always turned around, and he continued on. He said, "I want to find somewhere." And he continued on to the outskirts of town, and there was a little girl, and he knocked upon the door, and this little girl answered the door, and then she looked at him and said, "We've got some food for you, and we've got a place for you to stay." And about that time, the father came, and he said, "He can't stay here. He's a beggar, and there's laws against that. If we take him in, we'll be in trouble. We can't take in a beggar." She said, "But Daddy, hey man, he's hungry. Look at him. He's starving. He hadn't had no food, and he's been sleeping on the street. Dad, we've got to do something." He said, "Fine, don't tell anybody." And he took the man in. And listen, as he took the man in, she said, "Sorry, but my daddy's worried that we'd get in trouble, but I wanted to feed you, and I wanted to clothe you, and I wanted you to have a place to rest, and I love you." And he said, "Little girl," he said, "just look into my eyes." And she stared into his eyes for some time, and then he said, "I've got to go now, you'll be all right." And he leaves and went back to the palace, and he redrobed himself in his royal garments. He mounted his chariot and went back down through town, and here comes a man trying to feed him, waving him down, saying, "Stop," but he kept on going. And he went down to the lady who clothed him, and he kept on going. going, and he passed up the man whose house he'd stayed at many times, and he began to beat on the door of the little girl, and her dad cried out and said, "Oh God, we're going to get in trouble for helping that beggar." But here comes the king with the sepulcher in hand, and as he stands there, he looks down at the little girl and he says, "Look into my eyes." And she says, "Oh daddy, it's the king. It's the king. We're going to be all right. It's the king." I'm telling you this morning, do you love God, or do you just see him from afar off? Have you had a relationship with God so much you can look in his eyes and know that he's going to supply your need? Let's stand across the building. When the king comes to your door, how will you recognize him? You're lost, don't know God as your Savior. You've not accepted the Lord in your heart, but you've still seen the mighty works of God. Maybe even in your life, or in the distance. It does not mean that everything's all right. The Bible says that we need to make our profession known. That we're to proclaim with our mouth. You know what that means? That means we make a public confession. The Lord has saved us. While they begin to sing, "If you're lost, don't know God," we want to invite you to come this morning.
Yes.
Maybe you've been around the church your whole life. Maybe you've been raised in the church. But you as an individual, do you have that relationship in your heart with God? While they sing, come. Come, let us pray with you. Let's make sure you know you're saved. King's coming. Come on.
Right,
we've took a test. Have you passed or failed? The greatest thing is when the teacher tells you, we'll go throw that question out. Bring your grade up. You're lost, don't know the Lord. The greatest thing is you can come. Hey, you can ace that test. You can pass with flying colors. You can know in your heart and everybody around you that you love the Lord and that you're saved. You don't have to leave here wondering if you've passed. Come on. You're lost, don't know the Lord. You need to come. I don't care if you're 9 or 90, you need to come.
Holy, holy is he.
Let God meet your need this morning.
Heaven's mercy see. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come.
Maybe we need to rekindle some of our love for God.
With all creation.
Could I invite you to come?
You are
I beg you to come, that God would be so real in your life.
Will adore
you would feel him in every step. Would you come this morning? Come on. Maybe you've got problems you need God's help with. Hey, this is where we go. Come on.
Flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy.
All creation
I sing.
for you.
Praise to the King of Kings.
Come on.
You are.